In this clip, we study techniques to identify processes in a given context. Imagine the following situation. We have an organization that delivers products to the market. Therefore, it regularly needs to buy goods. As they explain it, the process goes as follows. Somebody at the purchasing department sends a purchase order to the vendor, and a copy is sent to the accounts payable office. After some time, the vendor sends the required goods to the warehouse. The warehouse receives the goods and tells the accounts payable office which goods have been received. The vendor sends also an invoice to the organization. The accounts payable office checks the invoice with the receiving document and the purchase order, and as all checks are okay, the office pays the vendor. This is an example execution of the purchase to pay process, as often being described by people who execute the process. But this is the only sequence allowed by the process. And of course the answer is no. For example, the goods received and invoice could be in a different order. And what happens if the check of the invoice is not okay? So a process describes all allowed sequences of activities to reach a goal. In this example, the goal is to receive goods in order to deliver their product. And the scenario that I just sketched is just one out of many sequences the process allows for. So what constitutes a process? A process describes all allowed sequences of activities to reach a common goal. And each activity should contribute to this goal. A sequence of activities from the start of the process is called a process instance. This process instance describes a single execution of the process. Note that a process can have loops, and thus that a process can describe infinitely many process instances. While modeling a process, you always need to ask yourself, what is the process instance resembling? What is the object that flows through the process? Typically, you can locate this object in an information model of the context. And a good rule of thumb that I always use is, each activity should have the same direct object, and this direct object is the process instance. So let us look at a simple webshop as an example. A small webshop has a catalog of products. These products can be available and then become unavailable for some time. Customers can order these products. They first create an offer, add available products to it, and then place the offer. Once the shop accepted the offer, the products on the offer will be delivered. In the meantime, the webshop sends an invoice to the customer. If the customer does not pay, up to 2 reminders are sent. And if the customer still does not pay, the customer will be blocked. And blocked customers can be unblocked by the webshop. We are asked to create a process model for the webshop. But remember my rule of thumb. I now have a problem because I recognize several activities, but not all of these activities have the same direct object. So this is a good indicator that there are multiple processes hidden in the context. Hence, let's apply the reflective modeling cycle on this context. The very first stage of the reflective modeling cycle is the problem identification, in which we ask ourselves, what is the problem? What questions should I answer? And in fact, the question I just raised about what is the process instance in the webshop is an example of such a question. As this example already shows, there are plenty of possibilities to model processes. So where do you start? A good first point is to divide your problem into smaller parts. We call this decomposition. So the question you need to address first is, can I decompose my problem into smaller subproblems? Or in the case of process modeling, the question becomes, can I decompose my context into smaller subprocesses? To do this decomposition in a structured way, we introduce the notion of process maps. In a process map, we classify all processes that we can identify into 3 classes. The first class are the core processes that directly contribute to the goals of the organization. One way to look at these is as being the primary process that directly adds value to the organization. Examples include manufacturing processes or services that the organization delivers to the customers. We draw core processes using a box with a sharp edge pointing to the right. With this point, we want to emphasize that the core processes directly contribute to the goal of the organization. Important to remember is that you not only identify the process, but that you also identify the process instance, the direct object the process is about. So my tip is, directly document this together with your process map, or even write it down in a small font next to the process, because otherwise you will forget. As a modeling convention, we position the processes in the canvas in an order. Processes more close to the left are closer to providers or suppliers, whereas processes more on the right are closer to the consumers and thus add more value to the organization. The second class of processes are support processes. These support the primary processes of the organization. Support processes can be triggered by the primary process. We already saw an example at the beginning of this clip, the purchase to pay process. This process is triggered if there is insufficient stock in the warehouse. Another type of support processes are processes that ensure that the core processes can be executed at all. Examples include human resource management and maintenance. Support processes are foundational to the core. We therefore draw the support processes below the core process using a box with an edge pointing upwards to indicate that they do not directly add value but support the core processes. And again, do not forget to directly identify for each process its direct object. As an expert tip, ensure this becomes a habit that each time you draw a process, you ask yourself, what is an instance of this process resembling? And if you cannot answer this question rightly, then you need to rethink your process. The last class of processes are management processes. These steer the organization, determine the goals, and set the mission and vision for the organization. One way to see the management processes is that if you consider the organization to be a Greek temple, then the management processes form the tympanum, the triangle on top, the decoration of the roof of the temple. These processes determine the being of the organization. We draw such processes using a box with a sharp edge pointing downwards to the core processes, as these set the requirements, the goals and the values for the core processes. In conclusion, a process map is an aid to identify processes in a given situation. It is a model of the organization that allows to classify processes into three categories: management processes, core processes, and support processes. In this course, we will focus on the core and support processes of an organization. And remember, the process map is a model, so you can apply the reflective modeling cycle on it as well. So let's do this on our example of the webshop. The first step, step zero, is to identify the problem. The question is to specify a process model. However, to answer this question, we first need to identify the processes. To do this, we will create a process map for the webshop. The question we need to ask ourselves first is, can we decompose this context into smaller subprocesses? The first process we can identify is about products. The webshop offers products, and these are sometimes unavailable. Hence, there is some process going on about availability of products. Next, we read that customers can start an offer, and that this offer is processed by the webshop. So that's a process as well. Then notice that there is a quite elaborate part about how invoices to customers are being processed by the organization. And because this is so elaborate, I make it a process as well. Then there's also something stated about customers that can be blocked and unblocked. Hence, there's also some customer process. Now that we have identified the processes, we can ask ourselves, what is the process instance for each of the four processes? The first process is about the availability of products. Hence, a logical choice is that process instances of this process resemble the products the webshop offers. The second process is about processing the offers customers place at the webshop. Hence, the process instance resembles offers. The third process is about the payment of offers by the customers. However, payment is not a direct object for all activities. Hence, we need to search for some other direct object. Going back to the text, we see that customers receive an invoice and pay an invoice. Hence, invoice is a good candidate as a direct object for the payment process. So let us decide for now the process instance of the payment process resemble invoices. The last part describes how customers are managed within the webshop. Hence, the customer would be a logical choice to be resembled by process instances of the customer process. So we have four processes: the product process, the offer process, the payment process, and the customer process. Can we classify these processes into the three classes defined by the process map? Let's start with the core processes. What processes are core processes for the webshop? Well, a webshop would not survive if it would not process any offer. Hence, the offer process is a core process. Similarly, the payment process is a core process. Without invoices being paid, the webshop would get bankrupt very quickly, and thus there's no business anymore. The product process is required, but as it is about the availability of products, it supports the offer process. If products become unavailable, they cannot be offered to customers. Hence, this is a support process. And similarly, the customer process is triggered by the payment process. If customers do not pay, they get blocked. It does not directly add value to the webshop, and hence, it is a support process. Now that we have classified all four processes, we can start drawing the process map. So here's the template, and let's draw the four processes in this canvas. How do we position these processes at the canvas? The core processes are the offer process and the payment process. And the payment process is triggered by the offer process. So I draw them, first the offer process and then the payment process in sequence. Next are the support processes. We position the product process and customer process below the core processes. As the product process influences the offer process, I place it below the offer process. And similarly, the customer process is triggered by the payment process, and thus I position it below the payment process. Notice that the section on management processes is empty. In this example, there were no management processes being mentioned. That does not mean these processes are not there. It just means that we did not identify them. As a last step, I add for each process its process instance, resulting in the final process map shown now in the slide. Although this last step is not necessary, I'll always do this to ensure that I do not forget what the process instance of each process is. And more importantly, it helps me in the information model. Each process instance should also be included in the information model. So adding the process instance gives me an additional validation for both the process and identification and for the information model. So two birds with one stone. To summarize, in this clip, we discussed that processes describe all possible, or better, all allowed sequences of activities to reach some goal. Such a sequence described by the process is called a process instance. And as a rule of thumb, this can often be seen as the direct object of the activities in the project, in the process. We have seen that process maps are a good aid to identify processes in a given context by classifying processes to be management processes, core processes, or support processes. And as process maps are models themselves, we can apply the reflective modeling cycle on them as well to create better models. Good luck modeling!